I want to talk about nuclear war. Nuclear War, a Scenario by Annie Jacobsen. This book is a great resource if you're interested in how a nuclear war would break down minute by minute, hour by hour. Like, this actually breaks down to minutes. Like, the first minute, the first 2 minutes, the first 3 minutes, the first 24 minutes, the book breaks down everything that could happen in a nuclear scenario. There's a lot of sources here where she's actually spoke to professionals who worked in the industry, well, in the field of the military and involved in nuclear, not only nuclear proliferation, but also nuclear security. So this book is really, really fascinating. I'm really interested in this book. I definitely highly recommend it. Even if you don't know anything about nuclear war and how the history, and it has little sections where it just gives you a little history on everything from ICBMs, everything from how the proliferation, how the nuclear weapons were developed, the difference between the atomic bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima and thermonuclear weapons. Thermonuclear weapons are sort of like two nuclear explosions. They use a nuclear explosion to set off an even bigger nuclear explosion. Did you know that at one point Russians had 35,000 nuclear warheads? United States had around 25,000 nuclear warheads. They had treaties put in place that sort of reduced the amount of nuclear warheads. But even now, each side has about 5,000. 1,700 are actively deployed, ready to launch. And she talks a lot about those concepts in this book right here. She talks about how there's different responsibilities as far as everybody who's in the president's cabinet, all the people in the military who's responsible for doing certain things. I can really see this being played out almost like a fictional story, like a movie or something. But this is just basically a scenario. And she interviews a lot of people, and she inserts this throughout the book. I can definitely see them turning this into a movie. It'll be something like Threads, but it'll give you more details on everything, how everything's really breaking down. I'm not going to go too much into how things really begin in this book, but it's a big eye-opener. For example, I didn't know that, if the U.S. were to launch ICBMs, intercontinental ballistic missiles, towards North Korea, that they would have to pretty much fly over Russia. I didn't really know that. And if there's a situation where the Russians and the U.S. don't have good relations and the Russians don't have the technology to really know for sure that the missiles aren't going towards their country, that alone could create a big mess. I didn't know that if the U.S. were to target places in North Korea, that the radiation alone would lead to a significant death toll in China and even affect Russia. I didn't even know that stuff. So this is a lot of stuff I didn't know. Really interesting read about this. The way this scenario plays out, it's not like a horror movie where people make stupid decisions like go down a dark alley when you know a slasher's out to get them by themselves. Nobody's really making really stupid decisions. I actually think the scenario could have been a little bit more complicated if the president's family was in question. That would have made it even more. I think if they do make it into a movie to really ramp up the drama, that might make it a little bit more interesting. It's really fascinating. So even though it's nonfiction, it's a scenario. It's nonfiction in the fact that she's gathering information from people and she's breaking it down in a what-if scenario. Like, this could happen, that could happen. One of the things in the books is that nuclear war cannot be fought because it should not be fought because it can't not be won. And that's really interesting. I kind of want to dig a little bit into that in a second, but she also talked about mutually assured destruction, the idea that if country A has nuclear weapons and country B has nuclear weapons, if they try to use against one another, if one tries to use nuclear weapons against the other one will retaliate, and they both will basically be destroyed. So in that sense, they have an inherent incentive to not attack one another, not try to destroy one another, which I thought was, it's an interesting concept. It's worked so far. Deterrence, the idea that you're going to maintain your nuclear stockpile to encourage your opposition to not attack you because you might attack them. But by maintaining your nuclear stockpile, you can maintain deterrence. I find that to be really fascinating. She talks a lot about that as well. Let me just comment a little bit on deterrence. This isn't really from the book. This is just my perspective, nuclear deterrence and how it can really break down. I think you really need four things for nuclear deterrence. You need nuclear warheads. You need a way of delivering the nuclear warheads to the targets. You also need a willingness to use them or a perception that you're willing to use them. Your enemies have to be convinced that you're willing to use them. If not, they could take advantage of the situation. The fourth element is your enemies have to have something to lose. There has to be a sense of to not really engage. I mentioned that because she said that nuclear war cannot be won. First, I know this sounds really strange. You have to look at different perspectives. How do you define win a nuclear war? I mean, for one, some people, in a conventional sense, I think it is possible for maybe one side to win a nuclear war, especially if the other side doesn't have nuclear weapons. Of course, even if they both have nuclear weapons, so maybe it's a scenario where you hit and don't get hit, where you try to use your nuclear weapons or asymmetrical assets, asymmetrical warfare, or any other type of warfare, sabotage or whatever, to prevent the other side from being able to launch. And then you launch and you're able to hit them and they're not able to hit you. Now, of course, that's incredibly difficult. That's not something I'm advocating for at all. But, you know, if somebody is convinced that they can win a nuclear war and you're convinced that nuclear war cannot be won, then that's a problem in the whole deterrence theory. Because one side, you don't have the same perspective. If one side thinks they can win, the other side thinks that there's no winning, that creates an imbalance where deterrence, even if they both have nuclear weapons, deterrence could break down. Another option is when I mentioned the fourth idea that your enemy has to have something to lose. If you push your enemy to a corner where they are convinced that they have nothing to lose, then deterrence could break down because they could. If country A convinces country B that they're going to be destroyed no matter what, the leader may come to the conclusion that the only way of winning is to actually get revenge and actually hit the enemy before they have a chance to actually destroy us, since you know, that person's convinced that they're going to be destroyed anyway. Of course, that's craziness, but that's a possible way that deterrence could break down. So these are just some of my ideas I'm just throwing out here. Yeah, I'm not advocating any type of nuclear war or anything like that. I don't want to see that happen at all. I want to see human civilization become a type one civilization where we have enough energy to harvest all the energy on planet Earth. Maybe even a type two civilization where we can build a Dyson sphere and or something and harvest all the energy of the sun. That's probably hundreds of years away, but that would be one hell of a project to actually try to build a Dyson sphere. I don't know if it's going to be completely containing the sun, but anyway, I would love to see the human race advance. I don't want to see nuclear Armageddon. Oh, she also talks a lot about how nuclear war would affect the American people, how many people would die in just immediate attacks. She goes into great detail as to how the nuclear bomb would affect people. She talks about air bursts, ground bursts, how if a nuclear weapon hits close to the ground, it throws up a bunch of dirt into the atmosphere, radioactive dirt, and it creates a lot more fallout than an air burst. That's something I knew about, but it's really interesting. Read about it some more. She talks about the radius, how you would be affected from a nuclear bomb depending on your distance. So this is really fascinating stuff. It's called Nuclear War, a Scenario by Annie Jacobsen, Pulitzer Prize finalist, author of First Platoon and Area 51. I haven't read her other books, so I might actually take the time to do that. But that's a subject right there that really interests me. So if you guys have any recommendations for any geopolitics, geopolitical books, anything related to nonfiction, the big picture, this is stuff that really interests me. So just want to share that with you guys. Thank you for watching. Thank you for being interested. Thank you for listening to me. I kind of want to know if you think deterrence will ever break down. What are some of the weaknesses in deterrence, in the theory of deterrence? Because I don't think we're ever going to get to the point where we remove nuclear weapons, but we have to get to the point where that we change leadership. We have to do something about the leadership, the people who have control over nuclear weapons. We have to do a better job of making sure that we get people in place who care more about the people than their own personal interests or their interests or special interests. Because my concern is that the corruption and you have some questionable people in leadership throughout the world. And there's a lot of countries with nuclear weapons. I think deterrence, it made more sense. We just had a Soviet Union and the United States. But it's we have a, when you have a lot more parties involved, it's going to be more difficult for that to really work out because you have different cultures, you have different perspectives. You have, okay, so now we have the United States. We have Russia. We also have China with nuclear weapons. We have the United Kingdom, of course, France. We have India and Pakistan, all right? And, you know, we have North Korea, to say the least. Oh, and Israel probably has nuclear weapons as well. So, you know, if countries get pushed into the corner and they feel like we're going to be destroyed anyway, we got nothing to lose, then maybe they decide to use nuclear weapons. If that happens, and maybe another country misreads that and thinks that, oh, well, they're using nuclear weapons, they're aiming it at us, maybe we should fire ours before they fire, before they hit us. That's another concept that's discussed in this book. Use it before you lose it, especially when it comes to the land, ICBMs, the land, nuclear weapons. And she goes a lot. She goes into a lot of detail about the nuclear triad. The nuclear triad, of course, that's being the nuclear submarines launching missiles with multiple warheads. You have the land-based ICBMs. The U.S. has stationary land-based ICBMs that launch out of silos. The Russians, by the way, have more mobile land launchers. And the third, of course, are air bombers. Air bombers is something you want to use if you want to do a first strike, because if you're retaliating, a lot of times they won't have enough time to load up their gear and actually take off and try to hit your enemy. So really fascinating, guys. Thank you for taking the time to listen. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for today. Got my potassium iodine pills.